morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for coming to our first TEFAF Coffee Talk, the launch, the second launch event of TEFAF Week. And we planned these cultural programs to augment the fair, to discuss issues that relate to the fair. And we have brought together for every one of the talks a stellar group of panelists, which is obvious from the introduction you're just about to hear. We hope you'll attend more during the course of the fair, but we're so happy to have you. So thank you so much.
Good morning, everyone. Can you hear me? Yeah. My name is Carrie Barratt. I'm the Deputy Director at the Metropolitan Museum of Art, and it's my pleasure this morning to be with all of you here on a rainy Saturday morning. Thanks for coming in. With four very prominent and one of the things we said had in common is kind of new directors, or within the past couple of years, have taken over the helm of their institutions. The format for this morning is we'll start by, I'm going to ask each of our four panelists to talk for about 5 or 7 minutes about various things going on in their museums. How does this new generation of museum leaders now at the helm adapt their institution to the rapidly changing environment while upholding core mission? One of my favorite things to ask, and I'll probably ask this again, you know, individually when we get into the discussion, is within the cities of Detroit, Hartford, Baltimore, and New York, what are the stories that you're telling your visitors? I think all of us agree that narrative in our lives is more and more important as we say, everyone on this panel was also a curator. I was too, a curator before becoming a director. So we come to these leadership positions, C-suite jobs in the museum world, with a capacity for engaging visitors, trying to become to maintain, let's say, the authority in our fields, never losing the authoritative capacity of museums to know about their collections, but continually engaging the public with what they bring to the table. So another way, a kind of a second way of framing that question is, what stories are you telling, and how often do you think about the story that your visitor is walking in with? How do you engage that person? How do you encounter them? The term visitor engagement is something that I think we all grapple with, and what does that even mean? And it's so easily the rabbit hole of visitor engagement becomes admissions, right? How many people and what are they paying? Is our museum free? If it's a suggested admission, we still want you to pay the whole thing. And that, I think, gets in the way sometimes of the true engagement, the diversification of audiences, community outreach, and just how we entice people to come into our museums and then get them to want to come back. And then speaking of museums of themselves, each of these four directors has just gone through, or is still going through, renovations. And so we only have an hour, but it will be interesting to think about all of these questions. How the museum space helps you tell those stories. I think it's a lot to talk about, but if we concentrate on the visitor this morning, on the visitor and visitor art collections, and how they're going through your various spaces, and I'll let them talk to you about the kinds of opportunities that each of them has now in their new museum. So let me just introduce the panelists, and then they can introduce themselves a little bit more with their own stories. Colin Bailey, to my far left, is the director of the Morgan Library and Museum since 2015, and since before that was director of the Fine Arts Museums of San Francisco. Where he'd been before that, we were used to having Colin in New York as the chief curator at the Frick, where he'd spent most of his career as chief curator as a scholar in 18th and 19th century French art. Julia Alexander is the Andrea B. and John H. Laporte director at the Walters Art Museum, the museum's fifth director and first woman. And I just, as a footnote to that, I don't know if any of you, how many of you saw the New York Times editorial this week that was about, you know, the men's club, and that there are no women directors in the top 12 great museums, and great museum is defined by attendance again, But there are great women at the helm of wonderful museums, and Julia is one of those. And we're so pleased to have you on the panel today. Before going to the Walters, Julia was Deputy Director for Curatorial Affairs at the San Diego Museum of Art, and before that, where we met for more than a decade at Yale at the Center for British Art, where you also taught. Salvador Salort is Director, President, and CEO, as of 2015, at the Detroit Institute of Arts. And prior to that, he is Curator of European Paintings and Executive Director of Collection Strategy and Information. So can't wait to hear from you in the newly revitalized sort of phoenix from the ashes of Detroit, really on an uptick now in the most exciting ways. And then Tom Loughman, the director and CEO of the Wadsworth Atheneum Museum of Arts, previously associate director for program and planning at the Clark, the 11th director of America's oldest museum, founded in 1842. What a smart man Daniel Wadsworth was when he went into cahoots with John Trumbull and said, "What that stuff that you're not giving to Yale, come up to Hartford and we'll start a little museum." It is one of my favorite museums in the country. So without further ado, maybe we'll start in that order. Colin, if you don't mind, if each of you could just sort of 5 minutes, just what are your current thoughts on life at the Morgan and how you're engaging visitors and what it's like in that Renzo Piano building? Thank you.
Thanks very much, Carrie. So I started my position in the Morgan about a year and 2 months ago, and it's a place that I had known well as a New Yorker living and working and researching at the Frick, but I had no real idea of the depth and expertise within the collections and the curatorial staff. It's an institution, as many of you know, with 8 curatorial departments, art, music, literature, medieval and Renaissance, illuminated manuscripts, and 2 departments that were created relatively recently, modern and contemporary drawings and photography. And the Morgan embarked on a modernism in a way in visual arts. It had always been engaged in modernism in literature, but it embarked on this with, I must say, with ambition and chutzpah and a sort of a certain caution. But now our exhibition schedule is populated by 20th and 21st century shows as well as medieval, Renaissance, 18th century. I inherited a building that became 10 years old in April. And when I'd been at the Frick, we had served as a temporary repository for some of the great works while they were stored in Miss Frick's bunker, the safest place in New York, while the Morgan was being the new building was being made. At San Francisco, I had actually inherited a building that was also about 10 years old, a huge building by Herzog and Buren that seemed to me to fulfill every need and desire that an institution would have. And so coming to the Morgan, I realized actually again how far-sighted the trustees had been to create, to offer Piano the opportunity to knit together the 3 disparate buildings that had been at the campus of the Morgan since 1988, but also to provide first-rate on-site storage for the large collections and the amenities that are sometimes slightly sniffed at, that institutions absolutely need to have. A good auditorium, good cloakrooms, places to eat and drink, places to have receptions, and an ed center, and a reading room, an excellent reading room. So the real estate that was added, perhaps even more importantly, doubling the exhibition spaces within the Morgan. So I'm learning. After a year or so, part of me feels I've been there for a very long time, and part of me feels I'm still just scrambling to keep up. What I would say to the points that Carrie's asked us to address. I inherited an institution where the programming was already robust. I did not come as had happened in San Francisco, where I arrived in a situation where my predecessor, the director, had died some time ago, and there was really a program to put in place. At the Morgan, the institution was very well programmed. And one of my mandate to my curators was, I want to see the most ambitious and the most exciting interpretation of your topics. And why? And we can ask for if there's an object that is important to you, and will really resonate. We can ask. We can't always. It won't always be given, and it won't always be possible to afford it. But we can ask. And I wanted to make the exhibitions look more visually exciting, and that is not in any contradiction to seriousness, thoughtfulness, and a narrative that is pitching high. And I will say that I would like to think this is true at the Frick as well, where I was a curator, but I don't think I've come across a group of curators who write as well for the general public as well as for their peers as I have found at the Morgan. So that when you come to any exhibition, it is interestingly introduced, the material, often, as someone said to me, you're looking at letters, reading about letters, aging eyes can be quite a challenge, but nonetheless, the intellectual vivacity for a wide audience is really important to us. And I read every label, every text. I need to learn the shows myself. So that is a way of doing it. So I feel that is powerful. And I'll also end, just because we're talking of a larger audience, the Morgan Library changed its name to the Morgan Library and Museum 10 years ago, when, one of our beloved and admired chief trustee, head of the board, Parker Gilbert, I think it cost him to see that word and museum added, because the library had been so much a part, it had been its identity. It was not because we were no longer a library, we'd always been a museum and library, but the signal was, we are a museum, as we are not for people who have a library card or who are coming to do research, although that of course is part of what we do. You do not have to know us to enter our doors, and as Charlie Peirce, one of my predecessors, said, we are not a WASP club, we are not. So how to keep the standards and the vitality as well as enlarging? And there we have all sorts of opportunities, and through programming and through free Fridays. We have Friday evenings are free, and they are the largest moment of our week, and everything is open. So it's not free for just coming in and seeing the Gilbert Hall. It's free for everything. And in a small institution, every initiative counts. So every opportunity to have a graduate intern from CUNY. I'll mention one thing, just for one final program, because you're talking about buildings. The one part of the Morgan that is the sort of sacrosanct McKim Library of 1906, the interiors were ravishingly restored in 2010 under Bill Griswold's directorship. It's the most spectacular space. The building itself is well maintained, but is now our focus for the plant. That's, we're not building again, we don't have to add, but we're looking. And we were available to Jorge Otero Payos, who's a professor at Columbia in the preservation department. He had a seminar at the Morgan for 20 graduate students in architecture. They were given the free run of the McKim. They worked with our research, our buildings people, our deputy director. Then they came up at the end with a program to revive and renew the McKim. And we brought our trustees to listen to some of these after we heard them. They were crackpot ideas for the most part, but they were so exciting to see these young architects find opportunities to revitalize and to be excited by this building. And so that collaboration, which was an opportunity to engage with a fine department of graduate students, has resonated with the staff and with the trustees and will help us. That is our one building challenge in the future.
Thank you, Colin. And Julia, how's life in Baltimore at the Walters?
Well, it's been a year and a half since the uprising, and there is no museum director in the country who goes to museum school to learn how to deal with literally having to think about putting hoarding on your windows because your public entrance is a glass door and another glass door, and the city's collection, because we are city-owned, two-thirds of our collection is city-owned, would have been there for everyone to enjoy. So it has been incredibly challenging, but really wonderfully rewarding. And I address the uprising only because that's the question. You know, you get, hi, you're from Baltimore, you had the uprising, and do you watch The Wire? And I always say, you know, we love The Wire because it was really the greatest contemporary visual interpretation. It was a great work of art. And why is a museum important? It's because we are the place that stores, that preserves, collects, maintains, and interprets the equivalent of movie and TV of the past, right? So we need to be able to think more broadly about the objects that we have and place them into our contemporary world and create equivalents. So when people talk about The Wire as just a TV show, I say, well, you know, actually no, it is one of the major art forms of our society. And so as you think about it, why don't you think about going to the museum and thinking about the objects that you're looking at, not just as totems, individual great works of art created by one individual for the pleasure of one user, but really totems that allow us to connect with the people who lived in the past. So you ask about the visitor, and we really are trying to break that down. We're thinking of ourselves, first and foremost, the staff as visitors. We visit the museum. We're thinking about the different communities. It's not just one type of visitor, right? It's not people of color. It's not the two, you know, four guys who grew up in the smallest part of Baltimore and have the most money ever. It's not for them only either. It's for all of us. So how do we create a place that has resonance for everyone? I'm not interested in, and our team is not interested in creating a museum that is relevant, because I can't make something relevant for you. All I can do is open all the doors and allow you to walk through and find relevance. So it's just thinking slightly differently about how we engage with our visitors, how we turn the kaleidoscope on the amazing collections that were collected by a variety of individuals, but primarily by two men who were really incredibly privileged. But what happened in 1931 was that Henry Walters gave two-thirds of his, well, what was actually all of his collection, two historic buildings at that time, his family home and a purpose-built museum building, and a quarter of his collection to be free and open, quote, for the benefit of the public. So we are really re-engaging with that mission. And I have the privilege of following a terrific museum director who made everything kind of sing at the Walters. So we're just fine-tuning at this point. We're celebrating 10 years of free, and all of our exhibitions are free as well. We don't charge for access to exhibitions, so all access to works of art is free. What we are trying to do is build engagement by creating unique opportunities. Everything we do is tethered to those collections or the exhibitions. So when we have a public program or on our Thursday evenings, where we now pull in over 10% of our audience comes on our free Thursday evenings, every Thursday night. And what we now do is we have, you know, we're making perfume, we're creating a smell of Baltimore with a performance artist. You can actually go online and take the quiz. Those of you who have been there, you can, you know, say what Baltimore smelled like for you, because we have a medieval senses exhibition on art and experience in the medieval world. So we are creating a perfume, which takes on great new meaning because we have recently had three sinkholes open because of the sewer lines. So, you know, I've always joked it's parking and toilets, and these past 2 years have really been all about the toilets. But then also we do things like have a make night where you can make recycled purses out of recycled bags, because we had an exhibition about recycling and reuse of materials in the Middle Ages. So we're tethering everything we do to the art that we have. And in the words of our manager of public programs who came, he said, my job is to do weird shit in the galleries. And that is exactly what our audiences love. They don't think they're gonna like to come and see Japanese vases or Sevres pottery or even Greek vases. What they want to know is, how do people use these objects? Who is the guy or the woman who made that object? And then how is it used over time? So we're telling those stories, and we're finding that what we're getting is the 150,000 people who walk through those doors, they come back and they're more engaged. 250 doesn't matter, 150 repeat users, that's what I want. So thank you.
Thank you, Julia. Salvador, over to you.
I've been in Detroit since 2008 and started as a curator there. And in the last 8 years that I've been working at the DIA, I lived one of the most intense periods that the city and the museum has lived in its history. Starting with the 2009 layoffs that the museum went through the passage of the millage in 2012, which was an unbelievable moment, but we felt support of the community and has changed and is changing the culture of the organization through also the very difficult times of the bankruptcy, where our collection was actually in danger. We could have had faced the possibility of having to liquidate at least part of our European masterworks. When I arrived in Detroit in 2008, I lived in downtown, and I used to go back home on a Friday night after listening to a nice jazz concert in a bar that doesn't exist anymore, and we were walking in the streets. There were no lights. There were no lights in downtown Detroit, or not even in the buildings. So you can actually see the stars at night in a downtown of a city. I thought it was extremely romantic. And
Scent of Detroit.
Scent of Detroit. But one of the things that caught my attention living in downtown Detroit my first year was, you know, I lived in Madrid, in Paris, in Rome, in cities. I'm a pedestrian. I like to take a public transportation, a walk on the sidewalk. So I would come down on Woodward Avenue, and I would be the only person walking in the streets, which kind of felt a little bit weird. But what struck me the most was the fact that when you walk on Woodward, you didn't know where to go. There was no sense of direction. We're like an attraction pole. So when I became director of the DIA 1 year ago, and we were going through finishing up our strategic plan, I said, how can we make the museum this center point, the point of attraction of the city? And we came up with a vision that I'm really excited, which is, you know, the DIA is becoming, or will become, the town square of the community, with everybody gathers, everybody is welcome, everybody's included, and it welcomes a diverse kinds of communities. We want the museum to play an active role in the community. We want the DIA to be part of the revitalization, the coming back of the city of Detroit. I don't know if you have been in the city of Detroit recently, but in the last year, there were 75 new restaurants open in the city. And if you plan for a reservation for a restaurant on a Monday night, you better have connections, because it's impossible. It's unbelievable how many people are moving downtown. And we want to be part of that revitalization. We want the museum to be play an active role in the city, helping the revitalization, for example, of neighborhoods, and working with the city in doing that. And this vision of transforming the grounds of the museum, working with CCS, with Wayne State, with the public Detroit Library, with the Historical Museum, with the Charles Wright Museum of African American History, or the Science Museum, it's a very, very compelling idea. And we are now, as I said, working with the city in transforming those grounds. And as you know, there is now a train. It's called the Q line, that is going to be connecting the northern parts of the city with the downtown. And there are two stops in front of the DIA. And we are hoping that this train would bring people from midtown Detroit to downtown, and the people who go to the sports events there will come back or will come to Midtown, taking the train and participating in all the things that we are planning to do in this new plaza or town square that we want to reactivate with programs and other activities. And this reactivation needs to be something that happens not only the exterior of the building, but also in the interior of the building. And how can we connect? How can we connect both? This is the first time in museum's history, at least since 1919, that the museum, the DIA, can actually be a real museum. It is the first time, as you know, that, and this is thanks to the bankruptcy, there were very good, positive things that came out of the bankruptcy, believe it or not. The DIA is now a public trust. It's independent from the city of Detroit. It owns its building, its ground, and its collection. And we are thinking of how we want to engage and be relevant to all our surrounding communities. When I became the director of the DIA, we looked at what was the demographic makeup of the three counties, that help the museum every year with this wonderful millage. And we found out that 28% of the people living in the three counties are or belong to African American communities. And while we want to be engaging all different communities in Detroit, we thought that the African American communities was our priority at this moment. And this is because 10% of our visitation is African American in the museum, and we wanted to close that gap from 10% to the 28% of African Americans who live in the Tree County area. For that reason, we launched this year an initiative called Reflecting Our Community that is going to start focusing first in the African American communities. There are five strategies that we are using to do that. The first one, of course, is having all our programs that we do right now bent towards the interests of the African American communities. The second strategy that we are using is, you know, focusing on collecting African American art, and also focusing on creating exhibitions and special programs related to art that would be of interest for the African American communities. I can give you some examples. One has been a very recent acquisition of a fantastic piece, a sculpture by David Hammonds that was really welcomed with a great acclaim in Detroit. We are looking as well as working with the Charles Ryan Museum of African American History, and we are developing an exhibition there called Detroit 67, which is going to focus on the 1967 riots. We're also creating, for example, a program called Guest of Honor. And this is a program that I've done as a curator of European art with the European Collection. In the past, we brought fantastic pieces by Van Gogh, Monet, Vermeer, from great museums. I show them in the context of our collection, I bring them and celebrate them. Can we do the same with great pieces by African American artists that come from amazing museums around the world? We're going to do that. Another strategy that we are following is to work with marketing organizations that are led by African Americans, because they know, they have the expertise on the kinds of messages that will be appealing. They know what are the vehicles to deliver those messages, and as well they know where are the communities that we need to be talking with. We want to make sure that we send the message across and that the message is going to be compelling for them. The fourth strategy that we are implementing is to create, and we will soon announce this, paid internship program. This paid internship program is a position for diversity. And what we want is the communities to know that working in a museum is something that everybody in the different communities can aspire to. Of course, and this is the fifth strategy, we cannot do this without the help of the different African-American communities. We don't want to impose our ideas to them because we don't really know what is of interest to them. So one of the things that we are doing right now is creating focus groups, creating conversations and dialogues with leaders in the African-American communities, with organizations led by African-Americans. They come to the museum, we have these conversations, and we listen from them what they hope the museum could be for their communities. How can we more be a more relevant organization and attractive organization for them? So this is a little bit some of how we are positioning the museum right now. And the staff is excited. We are excited. And we have a very, very interesting upcoming years.
Well done. Tom.
Well, I'm the one who started most recently. I moved to Hartford in February. And in the process of looking at the community and the institution, it was very revelatory to me of a series of paradoxes. I'd just like to go over a few of them. So we are the oldest art museum in America, in this hemisphere, actually. Yet we would have made that list of the 12 important ones because we're a smaller place in a smaller city. We're the flagship visual arts institution for the state of Connecticut. There is no other encyclopedic art museum that's outward facing of our scale and type in the state. We represent the cultural traditions and heritage of Europe from antiquity to today, of North America particularly, having been founded by Daniel Wadsworth as a place for the art of his time happening in New England in the first half of the 19th century. And we've got a rather outsized profile as a collector and exhibitor of modern and contemporary art. Many of you know our 42-year-old Matrix program as being that place that gave so many artists, we're in our 175th project now, a fulcrum opportunity mid-career to refocus their work and to grow. So there's like that great depth of activity, but it's happening in a city of 120,000 people, in a metro area of about 1 million people. And that just makes for a different scale of everything. Another great dichotomy. The median household income in the city of Hartford is $30,000. $30,000. We're home to one of the eight promise zones in our country, which are the most abjectly poor, at-risk communities in North America. And yet, our metro area has the highest GDP per person in the country. And that's a great dichotomy if you think about that. A place of the generation of amazing amounts of wealth, but an abjectly poor capital city. Another great dichotomy, we now have about 50,000 works of art, and as I mentioned, our public profile is very much about European Old Master Painting and Sculpture and Decorative Arts. We were the recipient of the Morgan Legacy 100 years ago of 1,350 works of European decorative arts. Everyone knows the story of Daniel Wadsworth and his colleagues trying to create a place for art in downtown Hartford, and the Atheneum is the third attempt at doing that. And people know about ModCon at our place. But what they don't realize is we've got an 8,000 object textile collection stretching from basically Byzantium to now. We've got an 8,000 object works on paper collection. We have one of the most intense archives of any art museum in America, having been the place where Chick Austin kind of invented the 20th century idea of the art museum, at least the Civic Art Museum, and a place where figures like Charles Cunningham bought with an amazing connoisseur's eye works not just of European and American art, but also antiquities, works of Asian art that are of a quality and caliber that's quite outsized for our community. So the question is what to do. I took the reins of an institution that had just gone through a fundamental renovation and reinstallation of two-thirds of its city block enclosure. So we renovated the Morgan Memorial Building, which is now 101 years old. We renovated the 1966 building that filled into the original facade that had been designed and built by Eithel and Town in 1842. What it leaves is the Avery Memorial, the first international-style art museum building ever built, opened in 1933. It's now 85 years old. It needs some more love and some infill. In the meantime, I've been trying to balance our program. We reopened a room of the same epoch as this grand room, and isn't this a marvelous grand room? Ours was a reception room in a home of one of the members of the Goodwin family in Hartford that was designed with maple interiors, William Morris wallpaper, Herter Brothers furniture commissioned for the room. That was one of the left undone parts of that wholesale renovation. We're about to represent to the public a third century mosaic from Antioch that came into the museum's collection 75 years ago and has been under a really tacky movie theater rug outside of our theater for 26 years. It's a great reveal. We're very excited about that. I was just telling Carrie before the panel, we're about to open an installation of called John Trumbull Visualizing the American Revolution. John Trumbull, America's first history painter. You're going to kill me after this for saying that, but not Leutze, but Trumbull. But we have not only the objects, but the close personal histories. We have the correspondence between Daniel Wadsworth and his wife's uncle, John Trumbull, when he commissioned the paintings in 1833. So this is an incredibly rich story. We're a place that I think in terms of narratives has restated in an integrated way the story of art, at least for Europe. And I think we've been quite sensitive in our telling of the story of art from World War II to now. Our installations are three-part. There's one that focuses on abstraction, one section that focuses on conceptual art, and one that thinks about the figure. Within the European displays, my colleague Linda Roth pulled off the most amazing integration of the world of ideas and the world of objects by creating a Kunst und Wunderkammer that uses not only those wonderful things that came from Morgan, but so many other great and quirky parts of a truly 17th century view of the world. So we have a narwhal horn cup that's ex-collection Rothschild, next to a narwhal horn, with then an immersive digital application, so that you're surrounded by this room, and you're able to, on a touch table, explore the ideas of alchemy and healing and faith as a way to get you to jump from one object to another through the room, or to open up a drawer and find an Andean 8th century coca bag, for example. So there's a lot of energy around that. And I wanted to say this morning that I think the narrative that you see happening in a place like the Kunstkammer is a shift toward who's doing the storytelling, equipping our audiences with the ability to forge their own way through the material has been incredibly powerful and resonant with today's publics. That's a marvelous thing when we give people every opportunity to incite their own curiosity, to delve further and to get closer to old art. I recently was asked to join the board of TEFAF New York, and somebody said to me, why would you do that? And I said, well, there's never been a greater opportunity for old art to flourish in our society. And they said, well, what do you mean? I said, well, you didn't have to read the Loeb Classical Library and memorize it all, because you have this thing in your breast pocket that instantly can tell you who Aeneas and Anchises were, for example. Or you have this thing in your pocket that can get you an incredibly robust avenue towards information that might pertain to old master paintings and sculpture and works of art.
It's a great time. He's died.
But I talk loud.
It's a great time for people to engage on their own speed. And lastly, you asked about the future of buildings. Well, we need to attend to the Avery building, but I also want to attend to the area around the museum, because we will only survive as an institution if we can violate our own walls, right, and become an idea in the community, much like the Metropolitan is today. Thinking about the Met, well, where are you? Well, I'm in a desert in North Africa, but I'm thinking about the Met and something that had happened there. That's my aspiration for the place. And the who that matters, we radically restated just 8 weeks ago this weekend by making a commitment to the residents of the city of Hartford, those people whose median household income is $30,000 a year, that they're free to come every day. Every hour we're open, they can come for free. And we created a constituency class. We gave them cards to the Wadsworth Welcome Program, just like you get at the Safeway. With a key fob, even, just like you get at the Safeway. And the early data coming back on who's utilizing this program was quite surprising to me. I was worried, would it be balanced to all the populations of the different neighborhoods throughout the city of Hartford? And the great people at Aetna helped us with an advertising campaign targeted at the residents of Hartford. But when we look at who joined, the majority of the people are younger than I am. And you don't need to join if you're a kid, because you're always free if you're a kid. So the majority of the people, like over 60%, are in the 22 to 45 year old demographic. And that gives me great hope. I feel like we did the right thing, because we've removed a barrier that was clearly there. You know, people in those first years of working, where maybe half their take home income is paying for their apartment and their car, right, in a new city that they've moved to, having graduated from the University of Chicago or Stanford or whatever. And it gives them an opportunity to explore and be part of that wonderful human conversation, which is the art of the past.
Thank you all so much. And I hope you all agree. I loved listening to all four of these really smart museum directors talking about how they're grappling in their own communities. We've heard about sensuality in art. We've heard about collaborations with the city. I think one of the things that I have lots of questions, but one of the things that I think you all have in common that we could address, it's very interesting that all of you talked about art, but mainly what you're talking about is sort of your situation in some ways, the situation of a museum, how the situation of Detroit has changed the nature of the museum. Even, Colin, I mean, within the city of New York, you know, where you are in that neighborhood and with a profile that used to be what you called sort of this WASPy enclave, how do you shift that within a city that, you know, within a neighborhood that is just a block from the New York Public Library and Fifth Avenue and lots of tourist traffics and hot dog carts, and how do you get that traffic to come to you? So I want to ask a question, and sort of we're happy to pop, I do want to get a few questions in, so rather than having long answers, I just say that the guidance from me would be short answers, but I still am, to go back to my original question, I think about marketing a lot. So no matter what you do, and marketing is kind of this, you know, you don't want it to be a dirty word where it becomes that you're pushing your content out to a community. But I heard recently a phrase that really caught me. It was what's called ethical marketing, which means, you know, instead of thinking about the stories that you can tell or the programs that you can put on, how do you think about the person who might be walking into one of your institutions right now? Who's your next customer? You know, what do they bring to the table? And for most of you, and I think even Colin is the one, what you're mostly also talking about are people that are local. We could, if we get there before 11:30, we could talk about global and international, because I know you're all working on that. But just for now, let's stick to local. You know, people with a key fob, people who are able now, Salvador, to take a bus and to actually get to your museum, which is a challenge. People in your case who are maybe even local might include tourists who are taking that long walk up from the Inner Harbor in Baltimore. That's a trek. You know, how do you get up to the Walters if what you want to do is eat crab and go to the the aquarium, but you still want people to get to you. So who is that next person? Specific question. Who's that person walking in the door? And what are they bringing that allows, I like what you said, Julia, it's not about making your collections relevant, it's about understanding who's looking at them, right? I don't know if that's a provocative question, but any one of you could start.
So, can I start?
Yeah, of course.
Okay. Thank you. I think what we are thinking about is recognizing that the Walters has a more important reputation outside of Baltimore than inside of Baltimore. So for us in this phase, we're actually focusing on the 70% of our visitors who are from Baltimore and the surrounding counties. So that's sort of a different place from where we had been. And you know, 5% of our visitors are international. The other percent is statewide and region-wide, but 70% of our visitors are from the surrounding counties. So then thinking about that, how can we be the donut hole rather than the donut? And what we are really looking at is our place. We are right in the center of Baltimore. We have 5 buildings, 3 historic buildings that are, you know, categorized as historic buildings, and 1 building that will be historic in 5 years, 1974. So we are looking at taking those buildings and using the architecture to create a resonance with the local individuals. So who are the people who built those buildings? Who are the artisans? How, maybe you had a relative that actually worked on building one of our homes. Who were the enslaved people who lived in those homes? And we're doing that not just through marketing and saying, come see, you know, the work of the artisan who built this great stucco, but we also recently purchased a letter from the enslaved cook of one of our buildings, writing to her owner, who had been imprisoned in Baltimore because he had espoused secessionist tendencies. And she's writing to him and she's saying, I make the very best food in Baltimore. You know that I am known for that. Not a day goes by that I don't think about you, but remember, I make your food, right? So she's talking about her worth. That is something that people think about. It relates to all of us, but it brings our 65% African American community really in the building through an object that isn't just made by an artist, but by an enslaved woman. So that's how we're trying to do that. Sorry.
No, it's fantastic.
Yeah, I mean, today, we'll probably welcome the 463rd person this week driving from Darien or some other part of the state of Connecticut who says, wow, this is great. Things have changed since I was here a few years ago. And someone at Visitor Services will say, when was the last time you're here? And they say, I think it was about 3 years ago. And then the Visitor Services person will say, well, what was the show? And they'll say, Impressionist in the Sea. And our person will smile and say, that was 11 years ago, ma'am. So welcoming back, you know, that next visitor, how we can get back to, as an institution, that place of such gravity that though we're 110 miles from this spot and we're 110 miles from the Gardner Museum or the MFA, that they choose us. So that's one kind of next visitor. And another kind of next visitor, we're very excited about. There are 11 universities within Hartford County, and one of them is a regional campus of the University of Connecticut, which is being relocated to across the street. So there'll be 2,300 students next autumn, and we're doing a lot of work on preparing for interfacing with that very upfront and symbiotic relationship with higher learning, which I think allows for a programmatic ramp against scholarship, and also it'll be a regenerative cycle. There's been this radical reinvestment in the infrastructure of downtown Hartford. It's not the Hartford you were afraid to go to 20 years ago, trust me. The UConn piece will bring a greater volume of people in to see it for themselves, that it's actually a marvelously historical place, our museum across the street from a 400-year-old burial ground.
Salvador, who's walking in your door right now? What are you doing for them?
I can talk about our target audience, since you are speaking in terms of marketing. And our target audience at the DI right now, it's families with young children, because they bring, and we can prove that, the most diversity in the museum. So that's where we are focusing right now. We want to be perceived as well by these families as a useful institution. Mm-hmm. And I was talking a little bit about how the role of the museum being an active place, an active organization in the city. We work a lot with the communities and our visitors, especially because every exhibition that we do or any programs that we think, we don't do it in isolation. We actually bring the communities for exhibitions, for installations of our galleries, for our programs in the early concept phases of these exhibitions, programs of installations. So, for example, we work for our permanent installation of the Asian galleries. We have a team that is that includes exhibition specialists, educators, curators, and community individuals who work early on into the identifying the themes on those galleries, who let us find what are those stories that we want to tell that are going to be relevant for the different communities. So feedback and constant evaluation, it is part of our daily business.
That's great. Colin, I love the idea of chutzpah at the Morgan Library. You use that term. Julia actually swore, but chutzpah is really good. And I don't know that I would even say that would be a term that we would normally think of being equated with an elite bastion like the Morgan Library, one with such historical venerability. But I think you're really turning things around.
Well, I think that idea. I'm trying to think about what I would say in answer to this question about visitor. Just to say, we are a small institution and not the premier institution in a big city. So we want to be somewhere that you will visit. You will, if you're coming to New York for the first time, you probably, the Morgan may not be your first port of call. But once you've come once, I just believe there is the curious generalist of any age. So if you've done any type of humanities, so any degree at a university, as an undergraduate, you had to learn about Lincoln and Einstein and Michelangelo, perhaps. And you come back to the Morgan on a Friday evening and you see examples somewhere from all these spheres of your previous, of your education. I really have a lot of faith in the curious layperson, and I believe that something like social media, even at the Morgan, the Instagram account has quadrupled. The curiosity and the availability of collections pitching high, but not closing doors. We have all the gamut of programming, but I'm convinced that the curiosity of an urban public is, of all ages, is the lifeblood of a place like the Morgan.
So I thought I would close today with a final question for all of you, addressed to the audience. Our audience is, this is interesting, we're all at an extraordinarily high-end fair. To a certain extent, all of you are necessarily preaching to a choir. You came because you're already interested in the arts and museums. You're interested in hearing what these four terrific directors had to say about their particular places. But if, knowing that this is the congregation this morning in this very, very elegant room where people will have open ears, what would each of you, briefly, what kind of advice would you give collectors, trustees, curators, generalists in art, the curious, and the learned that can actually help us do our job better in our own community. What can this group do leaving here today? If we think about visitors and we think about almost like, I love your key fob thing. I also think a lot about creating tribes, you know, once you're part of a club, it's what Dallas did, you know, it's like a frequent flyer program for museums. And ooh, I have that, and not only does that mean something for me, but now I'm connected. And so that's, you know, you'd say, did you get the key fob from the, I can just imagine from, it's such a good idea. But if all of us say that we're within that, in that Venn diagram of people in the world who love museums and go to museums all out, we plan trips around museums. Others don't. But what would be that maybe one piece of advice you could give that would help evangelize great small museums and museums that in previously challenged areas?
I mean, I've got two. One is a plea as advocates. Never lose sight of the fact that we exist to bring people closer to what it is to be human. Okay, I mean, we all went to that course where we learned about the spreadsheets and everything. But at the end of the day, it's about bringing people closer to what it is to be human. They actually get to see in works of art the creative impulse, which is uniquely human. So that's one thing. And then the other, and since they've said outrageous things, I get to say that outrageous things. So we have the greatest collection of 17th century American furniture, maybe on the planet. And I said recently to somebody, I take it as our personal charge to be the Justin Timberlake of brown furniture and to bring sexy back.
I would say, and Tom didn't even talk about the guns, but anyway, so there, you've all those revolvers. Anyway, Salvador, how about you? What would you ask of this group to help you in Detroit and to help museums in general?
I'd like to be our museum's a place that is much more diverse. We're very focusing on that right now in the museum. We're looking at a diverse audience. We're also looking at diverse staff. We're looking at diverse boards. So I think diversity brings to the organization a lot of wealth and knowledge and intelligence. It's going to help how we perform. So I would ask the audience to, you know, look around and see who could you bring to the museum, the things that the museum is not a place for them because it looks too European, that building, all the installation is Eurocentric. But can we look at the collections in different ways? Can we make these places the gathering place for all the communities? You know, the town square.
That's a great answer. Julia?
So I also have two, and I just want to tell you that they say that women who swear are smart. So, the first one is a kind of reality check. We are all up here thanks to the grace of generous support from all of you. Don't lose hope, faith, or interest in philanthropy. 2/3 of all of our budgets comes from money from individuals. Collecting art is terrific. We need to keep our doors open so that everyone can come in. And we were built in an environment that was a philanthropic environment. So in this voting season, don't just vote early, vote often, but give early and give often. And then the second thing is, it's just a riff on what they said. You know, I always encourage people to go in with and look through the kaleidoscope. You know, Egyptian art, what is Egyptian art? It's not just, quote unquote, the cradle of European civilization, but it is also a collection of a culture and life that was made on the African continent. So let's just keep turning the kaleidoscope so that we can think more inclusively, and then that will broaden our eyes, and that will engage us in different questions. So that's what I would say.
Colin.
So coming last means everyone has spoken
so
well.
You can wrap up for us, yeah.
So I'm going to say three things. I'm going to say philanthropy, multivalency, and a compact. What I mean by that is, any of you who are engaged in a museum because you're collectors, because you're philanthropists, because you're passionate about a certain area, you will establish a relationship with the curators of those institutions. They will help you. They will be advising you at times. you will then establish a relationship through the curators with the institution, its directors, its support group. We expect you to be fascinated by one thing. If you are a passionate collector or a specialist in one area, you will probably want to see more shows around the areas that you like or you collect in or you're knowledgeable about. And the museum will help you, but you help us back. And some of these larger issues about diversity, about reach, about support for some of the nuts and bolts, that's really what you should be doing too.
I want to just thank you all so much, and thank you all for being so attentive this morning. I think this has been a terrific panel, raised many, many ideas. We don't have a Q&A portion of these panels, but our speakers are happy to take questions. I've been told that because this room has to now flip into a restaurant, that if we'll take questions out in the hall. All of us will be out in the hall right after this, and come back to other of the panels. Thank you so much.